for something and you want to go to a company and sort of put your spin on it and sell it, okay? Well, it's very important to know that ideas are not protectable.
Even if you come with a prototype already?
Well, prototype is something different, right? Because then you have the copyright in the prototype.
Okay.
Because for copyright to attach, it has to be in a fixed medium, a fixed tangible medium. It cannot just be an idea, okay? And this is really important. If anybody here does sort of commissions for, like, public spaces, for example, you might notice that they put out an RFP, a request for proposal, right? And they say, well, what is your idea for this artwork? So think of the Vietnam Memorial. And when they put out that call and they told people, submit your ideas for this, and people would submit sketches or ideas about it, okay? But it's very important to understand that the idea itself is not protected, okay? The document that has the drawing of the idea is protected, but that doesn't protect the idea. Okay? So we have something called an NDA, a non-disclosure agreement, NDA. And this is a form that, let's say, you know, you have this idea, or even it could be a business idea that you might have and you want to talk to people about it. You might want them to get to sign that, which just says that basically you expect them to keep this in confidence, that it's confidential, that you plan on making money off of this, and you don't want them sharing that with other people. So you have to be very, very careful, right, in order to protect yourself, that you do know the difference between an idea and then a representation of that idea. And I actually have an example here in the handout on page 6, but it's about Romeo and Juliet, okay? Now you notice here's Romeo and Juliet, then we have West Side Story. West Side Story was created based on Romeo and Juliet, and then we have a new animation feature called Gnomeo and Juliet. Anybody see that one? Okay, they're all basically the same story, okay? But that's because the plot itself is not protectable. Boy meets girl, boy loses girl, boy gets girl back. Okay, every romantic comedy is based on that same storyline. Okay, so the plot cannot be protected, but the fixed expression of it, right? West Side Story is a musical. Okay, Gnomeo is animation. Okay, so you have to understand the difference between the idea and the expression of it. The other one that I have here is an example of Mona Lisa. Now, first of all, we would say, well, Mona Lisa is in the public domain, right? I mean, she's how many years old? Yeah, she's what, over 500? She still looks good, right? And many people are amazed. Any of you ever seen the real Mona Lisa? What did you think when you saw it?
Small.
Small, right? You sort of look at it and say, that's it. That's what all everything's about. That, you know, it's very, very small. But people love to represent Mona Lisa, and that's a website where they put Mona Lisa in all different kind of outfits. And you know, she's got Miss Piggy head, and another one she's made out of fruits. I mean, it's just really a lot of fun. If you want a cool little activity and to be part of the Mona Lisa movement, you can go there and submit your own Mona Lisa, and it'll go on there. But it's a really cool little fun thing there. So that takes care of the idea question. The second question wasn't really a question, but it came up in their conversation. She's my girlfriend. I don't need to give her a release. Okay? He's my boyfriend. He's going to do this for me. He's my husband. He's my cousin. He's my mom. She's my mom. Not he's my mom. She's my mom. You know, or those kinds of things. Those work out great when there's no money. And I always tell people, contracts protect friendships, protect marriages, keep families together. Okay? Because a contract keeps the business part out of the personal part. Okay? And that's really important because you want to say, your family, you know, there's nobody like your family. You really don't want to do anything that's going to mess that up. So if you have the contract in place, it protects them and it protects you. Okay, so that's really important. So be careful when you say, well, she's my girlfriend, you know, we're just friends. This happens a lot in the music industry. Okay, bands get together. You want to know why there's so many bands that are one-hit wonders? In-house fighting. They get that first success and that was it. They can never produce again because all of a sudden, who wrote what? Who sang what? Who was this? Who was that? Right? And so then it deteriorates. So it's very important to have those kind of contracts and to maintain those kind of relationships. Okay, you're on.
I have a question about the band.
Yep. Public art, yeah. We haven't seen a case. And even this case that I brought up, right, it was a mural on a public building. It just hasn't been tested through the courts. We don't know. See, one of the things about the law is that the law is reactive, right? The law only starts the wheels rolling when something happens, okay? So until we get a case, we just don't know. Yep. That's the postcard. They have the copyright on the postcard. No. No. Right, the image, most of the pieces that are in a museum are already in the public domain, the image itself, okay? But the fact that it is a private enterprise, right? You have to go in to a museum, you have to pay to go to a museum, they can then set the rules as to whether you can take photos or not. It's just like in your home, if you use your home as a studio, you can tell people you cannot take photos here of my work. Okay, you can even have a little sign that says you cannot take photos of my work. Even if you think that might be uncomfortable, but it is another way to protect your artwork. If you have an open house, you know, and people are coming in, put up those signs. You cannot photograph. Photography prohibited. Okay? Yes. Just to make him mad? That's not nice. I don't know if I want you as my friend. Yeah, look what I got. Oh, okay. Any other questions? Before we go on. Yes.
Say you agreed to work with somebody and made some art. You find it in a newspaper with someone else over it, yet they kind of copied that off like that.
What do you mean, cover?
Well, as in the photograph of my artwork.
That's
had tissue paper over it.
Okay, so we have artwork, and then we have tissue paper over it.
I could have see it.
I'm going to tell you that you're biased, right? It's your artwork. You're going to see stuff that others will not see. You'll see details that people will not see. And that's just true, okay? And that's fine. Did they say that it belonged to somebody else or that somebody else had done it? They mentioned nothing. Okay. Now, here's another exception to the rule. Newsworthiness. Okay, newsworthiness. Reporters and journalists do have an exception that if they're covering an event, like an art opening, they can take a photo without permission because it's considered that it's in the public interest. That's news, okay? Now, if there was a caption in that photo that claimed that it belonged to somebody else, then you can send them a letter to correct that. If that other person was claiming that he had done it, you can then do what? Send a cease and desist letter to him saying you did not do that, okay? But if it's just in the newspaper because it's in an art gallery or in an art festival and the news is being covered, you're not going to have a cause of action. Okay?
I myself thought that probably it would have nothing to do. I would say the entity that did it, you know, I'm not trying to ruin that relationship.
Yeah, but if I was you, right? But if I was you and looking at that picture, you can really tell it's your artwork. I would say, you know, thank you so much for doing that. But could you put my credit there? Could you put my name and my website? Could you just print that in there? You know, and use it as an opportunity. Not everything has to end up negative, right? Not everything has to end up negative. Something that starts out really bad can actually end up being very, very positive. I had an artist, she did a Christmas ornament, and there was a big company that did home decor, and they took her ornaments and they put it on plates and mugs and different things like that. And we were able to negotiate that not only did they give her credit and they gave her a nice check and settlement, but they then hired her as a licensed designer for them. So you never know, right, what can happen if you're willing to be level-headed and compromise a little bit. And I know for artists that's really hard because it's your artwork, right? It's hard. It's your baby. But sometimes you have to sort of give a little as well so that at the end, now, you know, her work is now shown all over the world. But it started off as what? A copyright infringement, right? But instead of going gung-ho, we're going to sue you, we can talk it out and look at this wonderful result that we ended up with, okay?
Like I said, I didn't make any crazy.
Yeah, you sort of have to pick your battles, right? You sort of have to pick them. But anybody who uses your images, there's nothing wrong with telling them, hey, put my name, right? Because that's your exposure. So there should be nothing wrong with that.
Okay.
I don't think it's the same because I don't think he has the same recognition that Apple will have, right? And this is what you just described is something that a lot of documentary filmmakers have a problem with. You know, we have a very famous case that took this filmmaker $481 to produce a film, right? It was about his parents. HBO wanted to broadcast it. It cost them over $400,000 in clearances and licenses. Because what happens in a documentary? What makes a documentary real, right? People, okay? And so people wear logos all over the place on our hats, you know, on our clothes. There's a Nike cap over there. All those things you have to get permission for. You know, one of the scenes had a happy birthday, people singing happy birthday. Well, you know what? You've got to pay to sing happy birthday in a film. So if you've noticed, if you ever go to restaurants now and they're going to sing happy birthday, they don't sing happy birthday to you. No, they go what? Happy, happy birthday. Happy, happy birthday. And they change it around, right? They got to change it around because if they sang happy birthday, they got to go pay somebody. That's right. Michael Jackson owned a lot of the Beatles catalog. And that's because music, the copyright to music is very different, right? Copyright in art, you have the artwork, there's the copyright, that's it. Music, you have a copyright for the music, the composition, you have a copyright for the lyrics, you have a copyright for the sound recording, which we call the master, you have a copyright for the performance of that song. Those are all spread into what we call performance rights organizations that are paid out through royalty between the publisher and the songwriter, and then you have the artists themselves. Right? But this is the reason why a couple of years ago, Leon Rimes had a song called I Can't Live Without You. Anybody remember that song?
Yeah.
Trisha Yearwood, it was a song that was written for a movie. The producers didn't like the way she sang it. And she refused to sing it the way they wanted to. So then they hired Trisha Yearwood to sing the song. Right? How can they do that? Well, because the copyrights are separate. They ended up having to pay Leanne Rimes for writing the song, Patricia Yearwood was allowed to sing it as long as they paid that royalty. And a sad, sad ending to that story, Patricia Yearwood won the CMA award for the same song and not Leanne Rimes. It was really, really sad. It just goes to show that in the music industry, all these rights, right, are bits and pieces that can get sold and given to different people. Okay?
Yeah, well, I think probably the fall in the same category. I like to read it. And I was wondering if you come in with an artwork idea and something like your idea, but your name or whoever you are can't give them the money they need to give them a producer or so they pulled you out. What rights does that have to do online as opposed to your artwork session?
Told you I talked too much. It's got to change now. Just hold on to it. So the question is, right, you have an art idea for a video game. A concept?
Sure. Right, something like a concept artist or idea. They like your idea, but your name isn't strong enough to pull that money from the game. So they pull you out and put somebody else's name in there. They have a little bit more accreditation with the game company. What rights would you have?
Anybody else does video games? Because this is very similar. There were a couple people here who said they did animation.
Yeah.
Okay, so the answer is going to be very similar. Okay, so question is, you've got an idea, you've got a concept for a video game or an animation series. You don't really have the clout, the reputation to be able to bring in the money so that you can produce it yourself. A production company comes in, they say, hey, we want to produce this. Do you have any rights? You absolutely have rights, but it depends on what you negotiate, okay? And sometimes, depending on your reputation, you can negotiate a lot, or if you're right in the beginning, you're going to negotiate a little bit less, okay? Most of the times, what they'll say is that you will be a creator, not a producer of the ultimate results, okay? And so they may pay you for your concept. And then they may say, that's it. And you'll get a royalty every time that game or app is downloaded. This happens a lot in animation or even in television production. People have lots of ideas, but they don't necessarily have the money to be able to produce that show or series, so they sell it to a production company. Okay? But they still keep the credit as creator if they negotiate the credit. Okay? You also have to be careful that when you're negotiating those things, that you do not assign the copyright completely. Because if you assign it to them, you lose the copyright. Okay? You can license it to them. But don't just assign it to them, because then you lose it. Probably not. There is a big difference between a copyright and a patent for a product, right? The patent protects the actual invention, the mechanism, the way the product is put together, the different elements of it. Microsoft just released that they're looking for a patent so that when you just slam your phone, it turns off. The idea of the clapper, right? Only now it's going to be for your cell phone. A copyright only protects the document that your idea is on, but it does not protect the idea. Okay, that's the difference with patents. And patents can take up to 3 years to get through and up to $100,000 to get through the process. So it's really an intense, intense process for that. Okay?
You got to bring it up. adjust your specific on the time frame to.
Time frame, specific on geography, right? A territory. So, you know, and this is even true if you have an art representative. You know, you don't have to have an art representative for the whole world, right? There could be an art representative just for the U.S. You can have an art representative for Europe, an art representative for South America. It all depends, okay? It doesn't only have to be universal in that way, okay? So I want to move on a little bit. I want to get into this issue of censorship. Anybody here does any kind of art that they might consider risque? Well, he got pointed out. Right there. And in others considered art. Yeah. One of the things that you have to understand with censorship is that it comes into play with another concept called obscenity. Okay, and that's where the law gets involved. When somebody starts classifying art as obscene. Now, the problem is that obscenity is a community standard, okay? So what's obscene in New York is not necessarily what's obscene in California, okay? But it may be very obscene in Georgia. Okay, so it depends on the community. They're the ones who's going to define what is obscene or not. And this has always raised a lot of controversy in the art world, right? Because for most of the time, art is not created. Even what may be considered risque or erotic art, it's not necessarily created with the emphasis of being obscene. And the problem is, in the law, we don't have a definition what is obscene. Okay, what we have is a judge who says, I can't define it, but I know it when I see it. You think that's going to help us in the art community? No, right? It's very, very difficult.
Here's the point I said, I really wanted to move from one neighborhood to the next, and if next door neighbors getting his wall painted, it was a bunch of fluffy-looking, tacky cartoon characters. He was complaining that it was violent. Because he tried to move away from the bad neighborhood to get away from the graffiti.
Yeah, we actually have a case going on right now in Georgia of a mural. It's on a private building, and it is a mural of different women, and they are topless, and the community is trying to get that mural taken down. No. No, they're just women, topless women. They have long skirts on. It's been on the news all last week that they're trying to take it down, but they can't because it's private property. But you know, the parents are complaining, you know, my kids walk down the street to get to school, I don't want them seeing that. Okay. You know, you want to be careful about that. But you know, it takes somebody to make the complaint. Now, the person who makes the complaint has to have a reason where they say, I've been harmed by it. Okay? So whether it's that my children are being harmed, and since my children can't sue, I'm the parent, I'm suing for my children, which is what they're doing with the mural. Okay? But in the case of a comic book, the same as, you know, we had a very famous case that went down last year, the Supreme Court said that violent video games are protected speech. Okay? So they cannot be banned. It's the parent's choice whether to buy it or not for the kid, okay? And the court is not going to step in and become the parent in that scenario. But that's the parent's decision, right? That's the parent's decision. Is it the law's role to come in and parent the child?
I have a couple questions.
Yes. Yes, yes, yes.
When somebody says, the Jacqueline Pope says, can someone copyright a word, for example, Pope, and the letters are in a design image, but you redesign the letters in a new image?
Okay.
So I guess, can
you? You cannot copyright a word, a name, a phrase. What you can do is trademark some of them. Now, a word like hope, which is just too generic, would not be eligible to be trademarked, okay? Now, if there is a graphical element to it, right? There's a heart around it or some kind of swiggles that uses certain font for the letters, that uses certain colors. That then becomes what we call a logo, okay? And that can be trademarked. Now, the issue here is that a trademark is supposed to identify a source in commerce. Okay, that's very important. It means that it has to identify somebody that's in business. Okay, it just can't be, well, you know, I did this image and now I want to trademark it. No, it has to be used to identify a source in commerce. Okay, so, you know, there's a hat back there. You have the Nike swoosh, right? You see that swoosh. You don't even have to see Nike. You know it represents Nike. Okay, you see the Coca-Cola bottle. You don't even have to see it say Coca-Cola. The bottle itself identifies it as Coca-Cola. So a trademark is very, very specific. Okay, it identifies a source in commerce.
Service mark. Trademark on a trademark, right? Service mark is for like things like a service. But
if
you're a
nonprofit,
you have a restaurant or a logo, you
need
a trademark for that.
You can also get a trademark. Yeah, you can get the trademark.
Anything?
No. But it's still identifying a source in commerce. You know, people just call it a service mark, but at the end of the day, it's still a trademark. Okay?
Okay. Let's say you do something like illegal. I was just talking completely legal, but it's sold in a state or a country where it's considered illegal. Can the people who offend it, can they come after you?
Why would it be illegal over there?
Two girls. It's a very ass movie.
A movie?
Yes.
Okay.
In Brazil, it's illegal. There's a lot of people about a whole lawsuit. But in the United States, it's illegal, so they're trying to sue the guy who created the video. But his explanation of the video was it's illegal in our country.
Right.
Right. So I'm trying to figure out how to. Exactly, where does the touchdown point come at where somebody can say, well, I want to sue because it doesn't have to be sold in the illegal state?
It has to be accessed, right? It talks about access. Now, online, we talk about where does the server reside, right? Where does the server reside? Do you know why we can't get rid of spam? Because the servers are in the Cayman Islands, and the long-arm statue of the U.S. doesn't reach that way. Okay? But things like that, that's why there's a lot of disclaimers on certain websites, a lot of disclaimers on certain content that's out there that says, you know, it's illegal in so-and-so place. Okay? I don't think the people in the U.S. have a recourse against him unless he made it accessible in the U.S. per se. And that would be like if he released it here. Which is something that's going on right now with the Islamic film.
Yeah.
Right? Because that was released on YouTube. And they took the guy into custody yesterday and they were, you know, talking to him about it. Now, there's also national security in that as well. So let me just tell you that freedom of speech is not absolute. And the moment that it touches national security, all bets are off. I'm sorry? But you can. It's just that your rights stop where somebody else's begins. Okay? Because the issue is we are in a society not of one person. Right? We are in societies of millions of people. And so nothing can be absolute. We have to somewhere make compromises for each other. If not, if it was all for me, and all for you, and all for him, and all for him, we'd have chaos. Okay? It's just like this is not a true democracy. This is a republic. We have representatives. Okay? But I'm not going to go into American history.
But I was asking this one, a friend of mine. What recourse would they have? You know, they can
Was it?
Well, that's what
Reason for the riots? Reason for the murder?
Yeah, right.
How does a film cause murder?
That's the same thing as a video game.
That's exactly it, right? Do you guys remember the movie, Woody Harrelson, Juliette Lewis?
Natural Born Killers,
right? And we had some copycats that came out of that, didn't we? And again, they wanted to blame the film. You can't. People have free will, okay? Now, what was interesting is just the Batman, The Dark Knight Rises, that incident that just happened, and we actually had Harvey Weinstein from Hollywood say, hey, we need to do something. But that is the industry regulating itself. Okay, that's not the law or government coming in and saying, this is what you have to do. That's the industry saying, we need to do something. Okay, that's the way that our system works. Okay, but nobody's going to blame, you know, Christian Bale for those murders and what happened in that theater.
I have a question.
Yes.
So when you were talking about contracts and what things should be in your agreement when you are the creator or the originator or working on something, Justin Anderson asks, should agreements be drawn up even if there's not paid, if you're not paid for the intended work being done?
Yes.
Louder.
Yes.
I want to tell you why. And this is very important because some of you may be asked, for a wonderful nonprofit, a wonderful charity, could you do something for us? Could you just create this image for us? We don't have money, but we would like this, okay? But remember, it is still your reputation as an artist. So you can still control the way it's being used or not used, okay? So if they ask you to do something for a campaign, for example, you have the right to say only for this campaign and that's it. You can't use it next year. Okay, you have the right to set up those conditions, but only if you put it in the contract and talk to them. I had a scenario where an artist came to me and says, you know, I did this for the nonprofit. Now they put it on postcards and they're selling it and they've got it on t-shirts and they've got it all this. And I said, well, what agreement did you have with them? Oh, I just told them I would do it. But, you know, they just said they wanted something for, you know, their website on this page. But now they're making all this money. And shouldn't I be getting some of that? Well, you know what? If you didn't negotiate it, no. Right? That's why those contracts are important. So even if you're not getting money, those contracts can still set up the parameters of how your art is used. Or even as simple as making sure that they put your name as the artist and give you credit for that. You know, they don't have to pay you in money. But they can have a website link to your website if somebody likes your art that they can go there. You can put that in the contract. Okay? Any other questions on that?
No, that was it.
That was it. Okay. Yes.
So how, going back to copyright and trademark, because the registration of a copyright seems to be easy. But for a trademark, say I want to start my own brand of my own clothing line. And I have my mark, that I would have to go beyond registering that copyright and making it into a trademark.
Right. The copyright wouldn't help you in that sense. And let's just talk a little bit about registration of trademarks, because it is more complicated, and it does cost a little bit more, okay? Now, it's also a different office. We have the U.S. Copyright Office. Trademarks are done in the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office, and that right off the bat should give you a sense that this is not going to be so straightforward. Patent and trademark, what it really is, unlike copyright, that they're really, you know, taking the form, taking the information, trademark is almost like a hearing. They are looking, they have attorneys on that side looking for reasons not to grant it to you. Okay? And so you really do need an attorney to help you with a trademark application. Trademarks are also done by category. That's why you have Delta Faucets and Delta Airlines. They're both Delta, but they're different categories, right? Okay? So it's really important to understand which categories you need. So, for example, if your brand, right, is going to be on t-shirts, that's one category. If it's going to be on a mug, that's a different category. If it's going to be movies, that's a different category.
So you need to file for all of those?
So let me give you a real world example. How many of you know SpongeBob? Not what?
Never heard of
him, right? But every time they come out with a new SpongeBob toy, they actually have to get a new trademark for it. Okay? And then they let those trademarks be abandoned because, you know, kids will play with a toy what? Twice and then that's it, right? So they don't have to renew it because trademark does need to be renewed first every 5 years and then after that every 10 years after that to show that the mark is still alive. So, you know, you've got your attorney helping you with this for a while. It's not something very simple. So it does cost a lot more than a copyright. Okay? And there's a whole procedure for that.
So small business, how do they go about having their little brand of cookies have a logo and sell those cookies?
Well, it'll be under food.
And how does that help the lawyer situation and the cost of...
Well, now you only have to file for one category instead of multiple, right? Okay, but if it's going to be something, you know, animation properties, art properties, can end up having a lot of different categories depending on how you license it. Well, there is, every state, first of all, has a bar association, okay? So the first thing you should do is any lawyer that you're going to talk to, make sure that they are licensed in that state. I'm licensed in New York and Georgia, so I can practice in New York and Georgia. I can practice at the state level, but I'm also admitted into the federal level. And most intellectual property will fall into federal court, okay? But I cannot practice in Florida because I'm not licensed there. Okay, so the first thing you should do is make sure your attorney is licensed there. And then there is not a copyright lawyer organization, but there are different organizations. Like there's the Copyright Society of the U.S. There is the Intellectual Property Section of the Georgia Bar Association. So there are different groups that lawyers will join, but there's not just one that says, okay, this is an intellectual property lawyer. Okay, most lawyers come out of law school like most doctors do, as generalists. And then once they get out there, because of the cases that they get, they sort of focus in on a particular niche. Okay, it might be because of the clients they get, those kinds of things. Okay, so probably don't want, well, I do know of an attorney who is now specialized in criminal entertainment law, unfortunately. But, you know, that's a very specific niche, right? But you do have every right when you are going to look for an attorney to interview that attorney, to find out what their experience is, and to make sure that they are a good fit for you. Attorneys are different. We give a very personal type of service, right? And it's a personality. Some people, you know, they'll see me in the first 30 minutes and they'll look me up and down and they say, nah, I don't think so. Other people may say, yeah, you know, I really like her sense of humor. It works out well. So you want to make sure that you get an attorney that is going to look out for your interests and that you feel is a good match. Okay? But don't feel that you just have to take any attorney that's there. It's your money. Okay? The other thing is that you have a right to fire the attorney at any moment. Talk about not having job stability, okay? But, you know, if you don't like something that we're doing, you can just say, that's it, it's over, I want another attorney. You're not stuck to that attorney. Understand that. Now, you still may have to pay the attorney for some of the work that they've done, but it doesn't necessarily mean that you have to keep them as your representative, right? Again, they're people that you've hired. It's the same as your CPA or your accountant, you're hiring them to give you this service, make sure that you're getting what you feel you need to get. Okay, very, very important. Good question that came up. We don't always get to talk about that issue there. Okay, how much time do we have?
I don't know. We've been talking for an hour and 47 minutes. So I think if you're ready for the last couple of questions, or one question more, think hard and think smart.
Last question.
She's smart, eh? That's right. Give it to the attorney.
That is a great question. I get that question a lot. Why can't I use LegalZoom? Why can't I go online and just download a template? Okay? My response to that is that a lot of these templates are written for a particular jurisdiction that in all probability is not yours, and therefore it would probably not be valid. Okay? But again, the Georgia Lawyers for the Arts has a wonderful library that you can make an appointment to go, because they will have forms and templates that are relevant here in Georgia. Okay? And, you know, getting a contract by an attorney is not as expensive as you might think. The other thing is, if you find an attorney, you know, I mentor a lot of law students. I teach entertainment law at UGA Law School. And I always tell my students, this is the kind of law that's built on relationships. Okay? My clients, you know, they might put me on retainer. I might not talk to them for 6 months, and then all of a sudden I've got to do all this stuff for them. But the idea is that they have an attorney. Anything that happens, you know, they just go to the person, hey, here's my attorney's card. Okay? And it's based on that kind of a personal service kind of a thing. Okay? So when you're putting together your art team, the people who are going to represent you, the people who are going to help you get to that next level, don't just think of CPAs and lawyers as, you know, I'm in trouble, now I need the lawyer. Sometimes if you get the lawyer ahead of time as part of your team, you can prevent a lot of that, and you can keep a lot of the value of your artwork. Okay, and that's one of the reasons why I do this, because a lot of people, they never meet an attorney until there's trouble. And then, you know, do I really want to go and see this person? I mean, I'm not happy to begin with because I'm in trouble, and now I've got to give all this money. And so a lot of people, they don't have an opportunity just to talk to an attorney, to see that, you know what, we're not big, scary wolves. Well, some of us are, but I'm not, okay? Okay. But, you know, just to have the opportunity to talk to an attorney, to see that we're people, to see that we're interested in the art. I am not an artist, but I love what my clients do, okay? So I hope that helps. There's a lot more in the handout, by the way. We just can't get to everything.
Everybody give her a hand, please. Ms. Deborah Gonzalez. Thank you for coming out. Thank Deidre Johnson for the goodies, yes, and the food. She's going to do a drawing also.
Everybody thought their name. Did everybody get a chance to?
Okay. Oh, you better get your name in there. Remember, the Black Book Conversations, we're online, tbbcatl.com. The address is up there. We're doing a 3-day conference where we will cover this, what she talked about today, and more. And so you can check out the website, artisking.org. Thank Jacob and Binders Art for their space. And thank you for being artists and being creative. So here we go. I put my name in like 5 times. I hope it works.
Okay, first one is Walt Borchick.
All right, Walt, come on up.
One you want to take? Oh, wow.
You can take Amazon.
So we've got 3 gift cards. He's picking between Amazon, Best Buy, and iTunes.
Wow. I gotta consult with my wife.
You gotta consult your wife? I'll let you consult. You gotta consult this attorney?
Amazon, she said.
Amazon?
She said
take the Amazon.
All right.
Thank you.
Okay. All right. One more name. Let's see. Victor Brown.
Victor? Okay, we've got one more.
All right, iTunes. Come on, iTunes. Patty Grieve Mullings. Come on up.
LTE. We just want to show you all the speed of the device and the different devices that we have. And also, you know, there's some food left. Y'all help yourself, okay?
Thank you, everybody, for coming. Check out the website. And stay tuned for next month. All right, thank you. Take a card. We have some binders.